Hello, it's me. I know, not the person you were expecting, right? Well, I just wanted to let you know that the podcast is changing yet again. Instead of having three hosts and the occasional guest, it's now just going to be Clayton and one guest so that we can focus more on the guest, on the person that he's talking to. Vanessa and Bree will be doing a sort of spin-off Q&A live podcast thing in the Discord servers every couple weeks to replace that more interactive side of it. This new format will allow Clayton to use his vast knowledge and bring on more interesting guests and give everything a bit of an academic twist. This first episode is a real treat, so stick around and see what it's about.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for listening to this episode of the Refold Podcast, where we talk about everything related to language learning. My name is Clayton, also known as George Pig, and I manage the community here at Refold. Today, we have a very special guest, a postdoctoral language researcher and longtime friend of mine, Don Killian. Don has lived in many different countries, researched languages with just 15 speakers in the Amazon, and organically acquired a few languages of his own. He wouldn't describe himself as a polyglot, but he is certainly polyliterate when it comes to reading things in his domains.
So, Don, do you want to introduce yourself? Give us a bit of your background.
All right, so I'm Don. I do linguistics. I graduated in 2015 with a PhD in general linguistics. So I wrote a grammar of a language spoken in Ethiopia, a minority language. And in general, the type of linguistics I deal with is sort of a very broad kind of comparing different things in language and then also trying to see how they work. So a deep dive into kind of the structure of language and the sounds of language.
Yeah, and was the language you worked on in Ethiopia Nilo-Saharan?
That's a bit of a tricky question. We'll just say that it's part of a small four-language family, so it's not really related to many other languages on a broad scale. So it's a four or five language family called Koma.
Sort of micro family.
Yeah.
Cool. So in addition to being a linguist, you also have perspective and background for learning languages. So if memory serves correctly, you speak some Portuguese, maybe functional and Finnish and some Finnic varieties. Do you want to elaborate on that?
Yeah, so I'd say that to varying degrees of fluency, I can speak Portuguese, German, Spanish and Finnish, and then I used to speak Swedish, but I think at this point I've forgotten too much of it. And then plus whatever those give me in terms of passive understanding. Those are languages I've learned to communicate in.
Okay, so you're communicative in those, but you're not, you know, necessarily C2 in all of them.
Yeah, I would say, so going by that scale, I'd say ranging from kind of, let me think, probably Spanish, it would be like B1-ish. Portuguese, well, used to be B2/C1, now more like B2-ish. Finnish might be C1. So, I don't know. And then German, B2, but a fairly solid one. So something like that.
All right. That's actually very impressive to me. That's a very good command of the range of languages that you do have. And I've known you for several years now over Discord and from linguistics communities. And you've always downplayed your ability in Finnish. So I was surprised to hear that you're about C1.
I think it depends a lot on sort of the specific medium. So I've attended lectures completely in Finnish. So a lot of my undergrad was all in Finnish. So it wasn't in English. So from a passive perspective, I would say the ability to take in a complete lecture in a foreign language puts you at a certain level. Actively, so it depends on, are we talking about, am I writing? Am I speaking? Am I reading? Am I... sort of, so it depends on the medium and the topic and stuff where my abilities range. I think typically in Finland, when they're discussing language skills, they often actually, they don't say my skill in language X is this, but rather they give a more breaking down into my reading is this, my writing is this, my speech is this, my listening is this. So they usually break it down into different sub parts of language, because I would say I'm much better in certain areas than others.
You know, I actually really like that approach, because I'm a big believer that skills can be quite imbalanced. For example, I understand Spanish fairly well, but when it comes to actually producing the language, I fall off a cliff. I mess up mood constantly, subjunctive, and I think that it's totally possible to have sort of an imbalance in your abilities and your domain, right? You can maybe attend a lecture, but then there's sort of an old-timey joke of like Soviet scientists coming to the U.S. and they can talk about their PhD stuff in English, but then they fail to order a hamburger at McDonald's.
I can actually completely go along with that. So in addition to the ones I've mentioned, I can read descriptive linguistics and some things in Dutch, in French, in some languages that I wouldn't, Italian, that I would never say I speak, but I've gotten used to the vocabulary and things enough, and they're related to languages I do speak, that I can handle those just fine in my area and in my domain and stuff. But so yes, I can read a linguistics article in French, even though I don't know French, but I could not order a hamburger in a restaurant without just gesturing or needing to hear somebody else say it first. So I fit that perfectly.
All right. I'm glad to have that confirmation. Because it's one thing that it's sort of an old-timey, I don't want to say joke, but a humorous quip about, you know.
Well, there can be some definite truth to it, though. I'm a living example of that one.
Now, when you learned your languages, how did you acquire them? So for you, SLA is essentially language learning. You don't see much of a distinction between like SLA and language learning as a concept, right?
No, but I have to say that I haven't dealt with second language acquisition sort of as a field much. So it's not my area. So I'm aware of it, and I'm aware there's different theories and different things there, but it's not my area of expertise. So it's possible my generalization about language learning versus second language acquisition deals with some sort of misunderstanding within the field.
Right. Because linguistics is very broad. You primarily work with like the grammar, you do deep dives, and you're really interested in, I'm not actually sure how to say the word. It's one of those words I've only ever seen written. Deixis?
Deixis. So deixis is, so that's deixis is things which you need to have the context to know what they mean. So so this and that, so the demonstratives are the ones we've talked about. And then also, tense is often actually temporal deixis, so now or then. So you need to know when something was said to know whether the now, when now refers to then personal pronouns. So I obviously refers to myself when I use it. It refers to Don, but when you use it, it's going to refer to you, etc. So these words which kind of take on different meanings in different contexts are often called deictic. So that's one of the areas I've been working in. Linguistics is a broad field. It is there's a lot of different areas you can work. So I would have very little in common, for instance, with some of the major ways people work in linguistics in the US. So generative linguistics, I don't deal with that very much. So my own area is very different from that.
Linguistics, the cognitive linguistics, where the people think that language, it's sort of like Sapir-Whorf type stuff. Is that more generative linguistics?
Generative linguistics comes from Chomsky, and they basically believe that there's language is kind of innate among all people, that and language is separate and distinct from anything else in the brain. So generativists kind of keep language something very separate from anything else, and then they and that everyone has it, and then they're trying to kind of work out some of the different features of the language, kind of based on the assumption that everybody has the same thing.
Right. So that's sort of where like the theory of universal grammar and stuff comes in.
Yeah. And I don't work in that field. So mine, I guess you could call it more like basic linguistic theory or language typology or that kind of thing. So, and it's people often sort of try and make a duology of, say, generative linguistics or kind of formal linguistics versus functional, but I wouldn't call myself that either. I just say that I tend to work in a more general frame, and then comparing and contrasting different structures across language without necessarily taking a very formal approach.
You know, one thing I do love hearing about is how different and varied linguistics is. Once upon a time, a year or two ago, we had a chat over Discord about, there were these like 1980s papers for like maybe some Visayan languages in the Philippines. Mm-hmm. And they were written in a way that was incomprehensible, not only to me, but also to you. The terminology and the vocabulary used was essentially nonsensical. And you had some very strong opinions about it. I can't remember that type of, what exactly that was called.
So that's a called tag memes or tag memics. So that's something that there's a rather famous linguist from the 1940s called Pike. So he came up with this from SIL, which is a religious organization which also does a lot of linguistic work. And what it was meant to do is kind of formalize a lot of linguistic work. It was kind of when computers were just becoming sort of well-known in some form or another, and people were idolizing math and computers and wanted to make linguistics more like them. It was during the 60s. But the way in which it happened in practice is it didn't work out. So what I'll do is here, I'm going to read a short sentence on a West African language, but it doesn't really matter what it's about because you will not understand any of this. Your listeners will not understand any of this. And I did not understand any of it. So sometimes when I teach linguistics, I actually use this as an example of what not to do if you're ever working on a language, because you remove the context of the sort of trend of the theory, and then suddenly nobody can actually understand your grammar anymore. It becomes basically a big paperweight. And so it's a door stopper. That's all it is, because nobody can understand it anymore. The context was completely lost. So here's an example. When rank shifted to manifest the HD place in NPT1, the NCPX has the same theoretical range of relationships with the RSC1 manifesting the MDL place as has the simple noun. However, no example shows an NPCX of type 3RS to manifest the HD place in any NPT1 with an MDL place, so that in practice the question of syntactic ambivalence has not yet arisen. Now, I have no idea what I just read. I should point out that all those RS and C1 and NPC things and stuff, none of that is explained anywhere in the whole book. So you just are supposed to know that from knowing tag memics, but all of those books explaining tag memics are long gone. You won't be able to find any of them anywhere. So you can't look any of those up either. So it basically just means that you have completely incomprehensible jargon nowadays. So. And yes,
that was totally incomprehensible. I will agree. Made no sense to me. And unfortunately, it sounds like this afflicted linguistics for a couple of decades, maybe from the 60s to the 80s, there's about.
Yeah, some areas got hit more than others. But anytime I run into these, I always get very frustrated because it's especially when you see a 400-page grammar and then you think, you know what, this is utterly useless because you can't do anything with it. There was one time I ran into that with a what's called a language isolate. So that means a language which has not sort of been shown to be related to any other language. And those tend to be a little bit special. And there was one in Brazil in the Northeast that has, I think at this point, less than 10 or 15 speakers. And the only description of that language in existence is a tag meme grammar. And I saw some hints that there are some really fascinating things in that language that I wanted to try and figure out more. And then after a while, I realized I'm just never going to get there with this grammar. It's so time consuming to get the most basic information out of it that it's just not worth it. So I just gave up and pretended as if it didn't have any description, because that made my sanity slightly better than knowing that the only description in existence is something which is useless.
That is unfortunate, especially because I think in the past couple of years, Brazil had a fire, maybe, or something. They lost a lot of information that they had
about
indigenous languages. It was a big tragedy.
I don't know if anything happened about this one in particular, but you're right, that fire did happen, and a lot was lost.
Yeah, and I don't know too much about the different languages in Brazil. I know that in the past 500 years, I think the Tupi-Guarani family spread out, and that was sort of the most common one, but it sounds like you're talking about an isolate that's just totally not related.
Yeah, correct. So it's one in the Northeast, and it's just not, so it hasn't been shown to be related to any other sort of language family. So it's not part of the Tupi-Guarani family. It's its own thing. And in addition, so Tupi-Guarani is kind of the biggest for that area, but there are some smaller families and some other language groups and things in Brazil as well. And unsurprisingly, none of them are doing very well.
Speaking of Brazil, this is really cool. So a lot of refolders, a lot of people in my community are really big into immersion. So learning a language without studying the grammar and just listening to people, talking to people, and sort of, I don't want to say naturally, because everything in the world is natural, but sort of organically acquiring a language. And I think that is how you actually acquired Portuguese. You basically went to Brazil and bing, bang, boom, you learned Portuguese.
Yeah. So a couple sort of hedging things with that. So that is how I learned Portuguese. However, I will say I did know basic high school Spanish. So as you know, American sort of levels of foreign language education is not very good. So high school level of Spanish, is, I'd say, is pretty bad in general. I don't think I was communicative in Spanish. But at the same time, I wasn't starting off with zero. And Spanish and Portuguese are relatively closely related. So it was not too hard to make a jump from one to the other. I wasn't going in completely zero. And obviously, Portuguese is related to English. So there's that as well. However, that being said, I didn't really have much in the way of formal schooling there. It was very much of an organic sort of learning by just talking to people and communicating and picking things up over time. So that is basically how I learned it. It's just that I did have a little bit of things beforehand.
So I have a little bit of a tangent here. Do you feel that learning only spoken Portuguese or primarily spoken Portuguese has impaired your understanding of like formal written Portuguese? Because some people, I'm not taking any stances here, believe that Brazilian Portuguese is in a sort of a situation of diglossia, where there's a high form and a low form, whereas the spoken variant tends to like avoid the object pronouns, for example, whereas the written variant.
It does. And yes, I would agree with you. So that I've become somewhat aware of some of the more formal things in general. I wouldn't know how to use them myself. In certain situations, I do have trouble following. So in the more formal situations, I can read it okay. I'd say where I can run into trouble is the news. So the news does tend to use a more formalized version of the Portuguese than you'll hear just kind of speaking with people. And they will use some of those object forms and some of the things that basically I would say are not used outside of school or very formal sort of circumstances. They're things which are not... you can't use them until you actually learn how to use them. So, which also means Brazilians who are not very well educated can also sometimes struggle with some of those things. Now, that being said, they're going to have more exposure to it and they're going to just, they'll still be able to watch the news without an issue, whereas I struggled more. But yes, I would say that there is something of a diglossia there, and the spoken language is, in many respects, a little bit simpler than some of the more formal things you'll get.
Yeah, so I think that like a lot of Brazilians sort of are collapsing the subjunctive mood. There's the object pronouns that are not used in spoken Brazilian Portuguese, and there's this weird thing called misoclesis with like the sort of the fusional verb forms with like
yeah. So for instance, and typically speaking in Brazil, what you'd say is if you wanted to say I saw him kind of like, or because you'd need an auxiliary if you're going to,
Like in Spanish, you would say like lo vi, and it would have that object pronoun. And I think in spoken Brazilian Portuguese, it's like eu vi para ele or something like.
Eu vi ele. So you wouldn't have the para, but you just because the verb to see doesn't it just takes direct objects. But yeah, you just say eu vi ele. I saw he, literally.
Yeah, I don't know, but I do have to say, I do, if anybody follows the Refold Discord servers and you see George Pig, I almost always have Brazilian funk playing on my Spotify. I think Portuguese is a great language, diglossy or not. It's fantastic to listen to. Something about the phono aesthetics is just very pleasant. The diphthongs, the nasal vowels.
I enjoy a lot of that aspect of Portuguese. I mean, so that was really nice. And I will, by the way, point out one thing with the kind of with the organic approach to learning a language and stuff. It's tough in the beginning. So when you kind of get tossed in and you have no language to communicate with people, it can be depressing. So if you will learn it faster. I guarantee that. But if you take a random American and toss them into some small community in, say, Vietnam and say, all right, here you go, and then come back a year later, they probably are going to have a very difficult sort of possibly even traumatic first few months before they start communicating with people. So it is a good way for learning a language, but it's also very tough on the human psyche. So I'm not sure how much that's ever been discussed with kind of some of the people you're thinking of when you're talking about the organic approach to language learning and such.
You know, I don't think it's actually been discussed very much, but there is a little bit of, I think, some knowledge that it can be isolating, not being able to understand what's going on. You turn on the TV, you don't understand. So I think that there is some notion that it can be isolating, but I think ultimately, most of the people in the Refold community are trying to replicate that, not necessarily being dropped off in a village in Vietnam, but by listening to Vietnamese news and watching Vietnamese shows. So it's a little bit different, I think, for most listeners. But I do agree. I think that it is isolating. And one thing that the Refold community is big on is frequency. So getting really good corpora and analyzing words by frequency. And sort of, I don't want to call it rote, but it's rote. Rote memorizing the first 1,000 or 2,000 most frequent like lexemes.
Okay. Not sure how that would work with something like Greenlandic, but sure.
Right. So it does fall apart when you deal with something like Greenlandic, where it's very hard to separate morphemes.
No, it's very easy to separate morphemes. It's just that every single word is going to be composed of 15 different morphemes. So aside from a certain few things like he goes, or you're going to get sort of present indicative kind of with very common semantic things. After that, you're going to then find that it doesn't hold up very well. You're going to have sort of low frequency of everything. The frequency won't work quite as well as with, say, Indo-European languages. That's a little bit of a side. So you were talking about the frequency approach. That's not a bad thing to do. I'm not usually a fan of memorization, but more kind of learning. So learning is more like taking what you hear and trying to incorporate into, so it's a little bit deeper levels than just memorization. So I would possibly not be as much of a favor of, so exposure to the frequent words, that sounds good, and so trying to use them.
I think I misrepresented it by saying rote memorization. So what we actually call it is priming, which is sort of like your mission is to acquaint yourself either with frequency lists or with flashcards, the most common things that you'll hear in the language, and then go out and find them in the wild. So in conversation, in media, because we believe that you need like several exposures to a word in different contexts to really acquire it.
I would say that's generally true. Where you're going to run into trouble is, so for nouns and verbs and certain things, that's going to be good. Where you're going to run into trouble with this is discourse particles. So those tricky little things that are often very, very frequent in language, that because they're so important to conversations that they add a little bit of a tone to it somehow. So they kind of maybe add some emphasis to something. So these tricky little things, but they're often really, really, really hard to pinpoint exactly what they do. And you sometimes see whole dissertations about a single word because they're so complex. So those discourse particles tend to be among the most frequent things in language, but they're also some of the trickiest. So I would say if you can, try to avoid those. Now, at least in the very, very beginning, because even if they're high frequency, they're not going to be something you're going to pick up even with 10 exposures. You're going to possibly get...
Particles are tricky, especially because they tend to be absent in a lot of languages from, like, written media, for example. You don't hear so many... For example, with Indonesian. Formal Indonesian only has 2 discourse particles. Spoken Indonesian has a lot more. So... I took a course from the University of Hawaii in Indonesian, and I've studied Indonesian, and I've read a couple of Indonesian books. I struggle to this day with Indonesian discourse particles because they're just not something that I was taught. I've not lived in Indonesia. I've not been to Indonesia. And a lot of written material just forgoes them. It just doesn't have them.
Yeah, so similarly here, so here in Finland, I did take some courses on sort of Finnish. So unlike in Brazil, I did undergo some formal schooling in Finnish. When they got into some of the discourse particles, they basically just had 2 sentences of something equivalent of listen to people and you'll pick it up, which is awful and not very good. And they're in fact very complex. Now, it's possible that some of my exposure, because I was also thinking languages like German, which do include some of these things like ja, doch, eben, so etwa. There are a number of discourse particles which are also used in kind of writing and such. So you will get exposure even in news and some of these things. And they're going to pop up very frequently. So they would be a high frequency thing. And they're going to be really tricky to handle. So, so at least with... some languages, they are going to be pretty tricky. So I don't know how many of your listeners would be, for instance, people interested in studying German, but I'll say that watch out for those. They're pretty tricky.
A fair number. I don't have the data off the top of my head, but I want to say that German is very popular among our listeners and our learners. Okay. And we actually have a whole bunch of natives as well in the community. I think Germans make up the 3rd or 4th largest community in Refold. I think something like 1/3 of our traffic or 1/4 of our traffic comes from Germany itself.
Okay. Well, in that case, at least those will be very familiar with some of these particles that I just mentioned, and they will probably agree. And then the native speakers are going to be where it's going to be helpful so that they can be the ones to try and explain some of them. But it can be tricky for some of the learners. Yeah, did you have any... discourse particles are tough. Sorry?
Discourse particles are tough. They're just tough all around. I think even with German, using them in formal situations, because they're so, I don't know, polysemous, they've got a lot of like different meanings depending on the context.
And that's exactly what I was getting at to begin with. So just that they're high frequency, but they're polysemous and they're heavily context dependent. So, and they're tricky. So, other than that, I'd say as long as you avoid those, then your frequency approach sounds really nice. Sounds good.
Yeah. I think it's a decent approach. And it's much better than, I don't know, memorizing fruits and vegetables and some other things that sometimes courseware tries to push on you, things that are not immediately useful or valuable for people who want to communicate and understand right away.
Yeah.
Now, speaking of, I want to shift gears here. Speaking of linguistics, do you want to tell us, and I'm sure most people are not going to totally understand, do you have anything exciting you're working on right now? Anything you want to share that you'd like to talk about?
Well, I can mention it's not something I'm working on myself, but there was a talk I attended in December, which I could mention, which might actually be useful for some of your listeners. So I'll jump into that before then getting into some of my own stuff. So that was actually from I saw a talk in December here in Finland from a cognitive scientist who's studying about language acquisition. And specifically, one of the things she's studying is kind of implicit learning where we're not aware we're learning something. So how much do we pick up, for instance, when we sleep, or if something's playing in the background or something like that? Which is, I think, a pretty good question for a lot of people. They're kind of wondering, okay, well, would I learn anything if I just have something playing in my sleep?
This is actually something the listeners are going to go crazy over, because we have a term that we sometimes refer to it as white noising, and it's divisive. Listening to something just in the background without paying attention, without actively trying to understand, and is it useful or is it not, is a very big dividing point in the community.
So here's some evidence for these. So now we've got some scientific evidence behind it, and if you need any of the references, I can get you those later on. Likewise, if any of your listeners are looking for the specific references, I can bring those up.
Yeah, I want to have them after, and I can drop them in the YouTube description.
Okay, sure. In the meanwhile, so during the talk, one of the things that we got out of it is that it depends on a number of things. So if a person's kind of, what is their starting level? Now, this I have to say, whether if you're starting at ground zero and having something in the background, you get zero out of it. So if you're listening to it at your sleep, but you, let's say you want to study French, but you've never studied French a word in your whole life, and you're interested in doing that. If you have it playing in the background, so a French movie or French music, or if you're kind of also if you are listening to it in your sleep, you don't really get much of anything. If, however, you have at least some basic familiarity, some sort of studies, maybe a couple of months, something like that, you still don't get much from sleep. You'll get a little bit. I don't remember the exact numbers, although I could check those. You can get a little bit, which is already nice. It's not absolutely nothing, although it's not great either. The one thing that I'm going to actually go in favor of one of your two groups when it says playing something in the background. That actually does work to an extent. So having something, so the white noise kind of thing that you're not focused on, you're going to be listening to or you're reading about something else and then you just have something in French going on in the background. That actually did have a fairly substantial positive impact on some of the language learning. Now, it's a question of, well, how do they know this? How do you test this? Because a lot of this is implicit and kind of... So what they did for testing this, it was all about reaction times and other things which are also implicit. So they never actually asked anyone anything sort of explicitly. Do you know this word? Do you do this? Can you understand it? It's all about sort of reaction times and recognition and how quickly do you respond to certain things. So all the testing and investigation for a lot of the language learning and language skills was also based on kind of implicit methods. And what they did for the background stuff, I think, is they first checked somebody's skills and then they followed them. Kind of, they had a number of participants and then they followed their skills over a month And then in order to create the background effect, I think they were asking, so they would put something on in the background and then they were asking some very, very difficult questions about something else that you had to give your full concentration on. So that they would say, okay, now here, answer this about, so they were making people concentrate on something else. Well, they had something, say French or something in the background, and then they would see, okay, if we then test their French later on, how much do they get? They did find some positive results with the background thing, but I'd say weak results with sleep. So then again, with sleep, you can almost feel like anything is better than nothing because it's just free. You're not actively doing anything other than sleeping anyway.
My question would be, would it like somehow disrupt the sleep architecture or something, having the input noise going on while you're sleeping? That would be my concern with sleep. Now, I'm not a sleep scientist, I don't really know, but that's
no. In fact, a lot of this is coming from the starting off ideas were basically, how much are children learning language outside of direct communication with other children and with adults and stuff? So if you take a child in a scenario, how much are they learning the language sort of just with things in the background? And the answer ends up being quite a bit, although not that much with sleep. Background conversations. Children do learn language from
you have shattered my preconceived notions about this, because I was definitely in the other camp of thinking that it was not useful at best, and at worst it was harmful.
Yeah, there's absolutely no evidence for harmful, so that one I can sort of rest your mind a little bit easier about. And then I'd say with the not helpful, if you're starting off at zero for a new language, then actually I would say that it is not helpful. That you don't really get much out of it. No. You need a little bit of a
base. I do think I heard of one study where they took students learning Mandarin, and one group listened to Mandarin without understanding it before they started studying, and one group did not. And I think they found that acquisition of tone was slightly improved in the group that listened without understanding compared to the base group, the control group. But that's one study, and I don't remember like the parameters, how well designed it was. But I think I've heard that when it comes to like starting with nothing, if the phonology might be something that you can learn a little bit without actually understanding.
Maybe. I don't think they found much in terms of statistics. So, however, it's a different question of, could a single individual, especially if they've got a little bit of a talent for sounds or something like that, could basic exposure already sort of, so maybe now we're getting a little bit back into the priming idea, could they be primed a little bit better? So if you get some exposure before you start studying, will you then sort of start to recognize some of the different sounds? And so I don't know, maybe, I would say in general, it's a fairly easy thing.
I love hearing maybe, because sometimes we just don't know. We're not sure yet. We don't have the data.
Yeah, as a scientist, I have to say that I hedge on almost everything, because I think this is why scientists are not always really great interviewees, because we're very hedging and very sort of, well, I don't know, it depends on the details, and so
it adds some oomph. When you actually believe something and you say it with conviction, it means it's probably very likely what you truly, truly believe based on the evidence at hand. So I appreciate it.
Yeah, so I'll get you some of those cognitive things, because those are some of the results there are going through dozens and dozens and dozens of studies. So that's really kind of, so in addition to kind of some of the main studies that they're checking, they're also having a large amount of sort of studies that they're then sort of combining and seeing what results happened and such. So I think those will be pretty good ones for what you're interested in and what your listeners might be interested in.
Yeah, that's exciting. This is awesome. My mind is blown, because like I said, I was definitely in the camp of like, it doesn't matter. It's not helpful. And I look forward to looking at the papers.
Yeah. Then maybe jumping a little bit to some of what I do. I've been primarily, since my PhD, I've been primarily looking at something called demonstrative. So now people know these primarily from words like this or that, and then their different functions. And then I'm also including...
They might be familiar with voila.
I'm sorry?
They might also be familiar with like voila in English. Like when you say something like, oh, voila, here it is, right?
So that's what's called a presentative, people are, well, they're going to be familiar with the voila as a word, they're not going to be aware that it's related to demonstratives. So at least probably not, especially because English borrows voila without borrowing voici. So voila is the distal one, the far away one, and voici is the other one. And we also use it a little bit differently than the way French would use it. So those are also included in things I look at, as well as things like here and there. And basically I had about 1150 languages. And for language typology, which is the field of looking at things from a cross-linguistic perspective, that's much larger than normal. So I'd say typical sort of language sample is maybe 200 to 400 languages. So I was had a larger sample, and then I was just trying to get into some of the rarer and more complex and more challenging things with how language handles space. So spatial deixis. So things like proximal and distal and stuff. And you get some really interesting things out there, things which are very, very, very different from English. Things that we might think are sort of universal are actually really not. Very different ways in which languages are arranged around the world.
So speaking of those languages, I think that the Austronesian language family has a lot of juicy stuff as far as you're concerned. Things like Tagalog or Cebuano.
Oh, they do. They do. So those are some of the Philippine ones have all sorts of interesting things. Then one of the most complex languages I've actually come across for demonstratives is an Austronesian language called Biak. And it's a little bit further away. It's spoken in Indonesia. And that one, if you add up all the different demonstrative forms, they've probably got thousands. And they're incredibly complex. You can get things like, because they have all these things like hither and thither, which we don't really use much anymore in English. So to here and from here, they've got all those forms, which can also be added. And then things like to a mountain or to the sea, or those in English obviously are not demonstratives, but in this language they are. And when they all end up combining, you can get things like that person, meaning, but that is the kind of far away, coming from the sea towards inland to a mountain kind of above, and you get all these incredibly detailed, complex things that you're just looking at and you're like, wow.
I think Austronesian as a whole actually had that when you go back a few thousand years to some degree. For example, the Tagalog word Timog means south, but in Indonesian, or Malay, Timur means east, and it had to do with like the direction of monsoon winds, and that's awesome. And speaking of like deixis in Austronesian languages, Malagasy is a really cool one because it's got seven layers of here versus there, this versus that, and it also has a different form for whether something is visible to the speaker or not.
And in addition to that, so all of those are correct. So Malagasy is amazing and awesome. And it has one thing which is actually unique in my database, that I haven't found anything quite like it. So here's an example of a very unusual language that I don't know where it got it from. But Malagasy has tense in the word like here and there. Also in prepositional phrases and some other things. So it's not just restricted to demonstratives. But if you're saying there or here, you have to specify whether it's a past tense or present tense, and which is separate from the tense of the main verb.
Interesting. Very interesting. Now, I know that some languages have tense in their question words, like where. For example, Cebuano has three different words for where, depending on the time of the action.
This is a little bit different from that. I'm not sure. It's been a while since I've looked at it, but let's say if you're talking about a location and then kind of let's say you ate breakfast there on Friday. So if I said something like that versus I'm going to eat breakfast there tomorrow, so both of those theirs are probably going to be different. Where the one where I talked about sort of I ate breakfast there 2 days ago, so then that's going to use the past tense versus tomorrow is going to use just the present slash future. So the basic one. So that's the most kind of clearest example. Now it gets messy with some of the details as you start to kind of, if you mix the present tense of the verb and then past tense of the demonstrative or vice versa. But in general, it's going to be if the person's thinking about something that already happened and then they're talking about a location, then those locations are going to be in the past. And then the devil's in the details as to how exactly it works.
Sure. And with a lot of Austronesian languages, tense as a whole is kind of iffy. At least from what I know with, you know, Indonesian, Malay, and Tagalog. Tagalog famously uses the currently ongoing aspect for, like, I am doing something in the past tense, or, you know, in the past to refer to something that is, like, you used to do frequently but no longer do.
So Tagalog, I wouldn't say has tense, and like most people who look at these kinds of languages, I would say these are all about aspect rather than tense. So it's kind of an aspect is about the construal of an event. So it's about, are you seeing an event sort of by itself, or is it connected to something else? How do these things go together? So English has aspect to an extent, but aspect is always kind of combined with tense in some way or another, whereas in languages like Tagalog, aspect is kind of the main thing, where you don't, right. You'll have you can tense in time of day
or something.
I'm sorry?
Which is why, for example, you would say something like back then or when I was a child, and then you would say when I was a child, I am cooking, essentially, you know, would be sort of like a literal word-for-word translation.
Yeah, something like that.
I used to cook, but now I don't. I used to do it frequently, habitually, now I don't.
Yeah.
All right. So we are about at time. Before we go, do you have any parting words, anything you want to say? It was an awesome interview. I'm very thankful to have you on.
Yeah, nothing too much coming to mind other than sort of, I'm happy to hear many people are interested in trying to learn languages and keep at it, so that it opens a lot of doors out there, knowing other languages. I've had some positive experiences, even some surprising ones. So there's one example I can think of where I was in a small grocery store in California, and then I asked a local worker there kind of where something was in English, and then he kind of just looked at me and went, and he was just looking down, and then I realized, oh, he probably doesn't know English. So then I switched and used Spanish with him, and suddenly I got this happy sort of effusive, his whole personality changed when he realized I could use Spanish, and then he actually took me to the aisle where it was and showed me where it was, and it opened some doors, and I saw a complete change in personality that I wouldn't have had if I didn't know Spanish. So I really saw some positive impact things, and I think in general it can open a lot of doors. So people can be different in different languages. I've had a lot of positive experiences with knowing different languages, and I think it can open a lot of doors for people.
Yeah, I think so. I've had those similar events with Spanish when I was also in the States. Famously, I have a story of going well past the whiskey limit at a bar because a table of migrant workers was just happy to have someone to converse with, and this bar had a 2-drink limit. And they were ordering for me, and it was not intentional, but I was happy to take the drinks. I wasn't going to turn them down. And yeah, it's a fantastic experience.
I want to thank you for listening to this episode of the Refold Podcast. If you're watching the live premiere, you're in luck. Right as it ends, we have an after party over in the Refold Central Discord server. Come join us by using refold.link/join and chat about the episode. If you enjoyed the podcast and would like to hear more, you can find older episodes to listen to on YouTube and Spotify. Let us know what you thought by liking the video and leaving a comment below. Do you have suggestions for upcoming visitors or requests for a particular topic?
please feel free to reach out to me on Discord at GeorgePig, hashtag 5413, or via email at clayton@refold.la. Thank you all for watching and or listening, and I'll see you next week.